Hey everyone, hope everyone's having a great Friday. Let's see, that's cool. There's already a bunch of you guys here. Welcome, Swenly, Diego, and Rutunje. How are you guys doing?
Hey,
great, ready to go.
I was just waiting to everyone to talk so I can talk by myself and nobody bothers me. How are you guys?
Oh, Diego,
ready with the knife.
Hey everyone.
So strategized. So let's see, today what we're going to talk about is the death of the one-point perspective. This is something that I've been talking about probably for 20 years, I would say, in my classes. And it's actually really, really, really important topic because if you don't understand how to actually deal with the idea of one point and what it really is and where it's worth using or not, you could potentially end up flattening out all your artwork, and you really want to understand like the rigidity of a box and how it actually works, right? So that's what we'll be talking about today. And my goal is to try to kill the use of one point as much as possible, okay? All right, so let's see what we've got going here. Before we get started, as always, please subscribe if you're interested in this channel and hit the bell button, right? That'll give you alerts to when we are coming on live or when we're prepared to put up a new live event. So this way you stay informed. As Matt Miller just said, hit the like button. he's doing Diego's job now for us. Thank you, Matt. So if you're new today and you don't know this yet, what we've been trying to work on is getting 150 likes in the 1 hour that we're live. And if we do so, then we have a very special giveaway for you guys.
Wink, wink.
Wink, wink. Yep. So the goal is to try to hit 150. Okay. So, please keep that in mind as we go throughout today. We'll check in on it. We'll check in on that number when we're halfway through. And of course, right now, at least our format is the first half hour, we're talking about a lesson. And then the second half an hour, we're going to take a look at artwork that you guys sent in. So we've already got that all queued up as well today. Okay.
By the way, guys, you can hype that thing on the chat, right? Because we can be all the session saying, come on, hit the like button. You can do it there. You are our helpers.
Helpers.
That's good.
Our helpers. Yeah. So, and thank you. Thank you for coming. A lot of you I see are, been here since the beginning and keep coming back every week. So thank you for joining us once again today. So here we go. Let's talk about one-point perspective, okay? So I'm going to do some drawing here for you guys.
Go ahead and shine, Mike.
Thank you. Show my true drawing abilities with a box. All right. Now, I know there's a little bit of a delay between, what I'm doing here and what you guys are going to see. So I'm just going to watch this, but you're going to see me draw a box. And what I want you guys to do is take a look at this box and tell me if you like this box or you don't like this box, and if what's right with it and what's wrong with it. And I want you guys to guide me through if it needs any adjustments. Okay. So it's showing up for you guys now. So you guys... tell me what you think. If you're somebody I already teach, please don't answer. I see there's some of you in here that I've mentored or on the website. Let's let the YouTube only folks try to figure this out. Okay. So yeah, take a look at this box, and I want to hear from you guys in the chat. What do you think of the box? And it says it's beautiful. That's fake perspective. It's wrong. So what's wrong with it, right? If we think it's wrong, well, then let's try and fix it. Right. Let's do the box the favor of trying to remedy itself. How do you deal with very symmetrical poses? We'll talk about that later, Carlos. The front shouldn't be square. Ah, okay. So Yosh T is onto something. It's very flat. It's
really flat.
Yeah. The lines aren't supposed to be perfectly parallel. Okay. So now we're onto something. The lines aren't supposed to be perfectly parallel. So let's try fixing that, right? The typical fix to that would be to say, well, these lines are supposed to go to a vanishing point. Let's start with that, right? So I'm going to do this. All right, so now we have a box that looks like this. Okay. How is, you're going to see me make changes in a second in Photoshop. I'm going to get our way to a vanishing point. Marco said, if we were to draw through the box, the far end would be larger than the front. Lines that move away from us need to vanish. Josh is saying it's got the wrong vanishing point. So here's a vanishing point, right? So what do you guys think about the red vanishing point and the red lines?
Radio silence.
Yeah.
This is really expensive.
Yeah, it's the death of radio, right? To have silence. I should have music on, like thinking music going on in the background. Exactly. Exactly. Yeah, so by now, hopefully you guys could see the vanishing point in the red line. So what do you guys think? Welcome, Barbara.
Now it's a bit warped, as Daniel says.
Yeah. See, now it's a bit warped. It's the y-axis.
Okay, hit us with the truth. Oh, my tongue today is completely twisted.
Untwist the tongue.
It needs two or more vanishing point. Noah
said it needs two or more. So how many vanishing points? I guess it's a question, right? How many vanishing points should this box have? We've created one. Yes, exactly, coffee shop sound. How many vanishing points should this box have? It's a good question. Three vanishing points from Marco. You're right. This box needs three vanishing points. So the problem here is even with the fix that we put up, we really still haven't solved the box yet. So the simple answer here is we have three surfaces and therefore really we should have three points and I've only affected with one point. Now, to that, let's see who said this before. Let me just find the artist here that said this. So Yosh T said earlier, like the front shouldn't be square. That in itself is a dead giveaway to the fact that there's a problem with this, right? So the problem here, right off the top, that Yosh T got at the very beginning of this video today at this live event, is that the front is a perfect box. So what does that mean? That means that every one of the corners on this box are 90 degree corners, right? Like so. I'm trying to really make sure that you guys are keeping up with the visuals that you're seeing today. So you'll see me curve out these 90 degree corners here in the corner of the box, right? There we go. So the answer I would, you know, the question I ask you is, how is it possible that we could see the top of the box? I'll put the letter T up there and S for the side. How would it be possible for us to see the top of this box and the side of the box and see the front straight on, right? Where it's squared off with 90 degree corners. You see, this is the trap. This is one of the traps of one point perspective, right? So you'll see numerous books that present this kind of thinking, and this is not the kind of perspective we want to draw with. This isn't true visual perspective. It's not the way your eye interprets perspective in the world, right? Sure, is this used like in architecture and other implementations? Sure, but it's not what I want you guys to learn when it comes to drawing. If you're drawing the figure, or even if you're drawing a scene out of imagination, right? You want to be really careful about doing this because you're skewing the box. And I'm going to show you this actually in a little bit with a real box as well. Okay. Okay. Marco says, if the corner is the closest part of the box that we see, the closest corner's angles need to be more than 90. Yeah, the angles will change. They'll become acute or obtuse. And there's all kinds of different reasons that happens. And we'll, at some future date, we'll do other videos on perspective, talking about the grid and what kind of grid I actually work with. It's in the books, obviously, as well, but we'll talk about that more.
One exercise, Mike, sorry I interrupt.
Yeah, please.
Well, one of the exercise you see in almost every single drawing book is the nine boxes, the nine square. Three on top, three in the middle,
right.
Three on the bottom, and
right.
Vanishing to one single vanishing point. And there's all the all nine examples, they all are actually eight examples of wrong one vanishing point. And you could say, okay, maybe it's not wrong. The other vanishing point is really, really far away. So that is why it's almost square. But if this is the first thing you learn, it would be great to be clear up that those squares or those cubes you're drawing on the top and the bottom on both sides of the middle are really not correct.
That's right.
So I want to mention this because it's something that always came up in the classes when you mentioned this.
Yeah, it's funny. I don't even use this as the example of wrong. There's another one we're going to draw, which I think is even more popular. But this is like a more sophisticated version of wrong. You know, I would agree with you. This is off. And I've seen people do this as well. And it still is the same problem, right? This is just now numerous examples of the same box that I just drew. They're all flat fronts, right? They all have where I'm drawing the X's that you're going to see in a second. All these X's have flat fronts, so they're 90 degree corners. And yet we're seeing all different types of sides of these boxes, right? So that's a problem. Boxes don't work like this, folks, right? It doesn't work like this. It's not how perspective works relative to the human eye and how our brain understands depth, okay? So to go to Diego's point, I would say the one that's even more obvious that I've seen and I even grew up with. Oh, and by the way, that box that I drew at the beginning today, I mean, I was taught to draw perspective with that box also. I mean, I remember very specifically my middle school teacher, seventh grade, said, hey, you know, learn how to draw a perspective box, right? Do this. And then what she said was draw that box again and then connect the corners, right? Yeah. So that's how I was first introduced to perspective. And I thought like, oh my God, this is so awesome. Look, I have a box that has all this dimensionality only to find out that, it's all wrong. The irony is in that same class, not only she teach us that box, but then she actually did start teaching us perspective grids. And the perspective grids actually don't work with this box, right? If you do the grid right and you're using the right kind of grid, this box would actually never show up in a perspective grid. It's impossible, you know? So again, be careful of that box, right? All right, so let's get on to what I see as the most common error in perspective. So the example I've always seen in books is, hey, you want to learn one point, like check out how to draw train tracks, right? So we have train tracks that go off to, you know, the book teaches you how this is the horizon line. Right? And those train tracks are like this. And then you draw these cross ties.
By the way, guys, while Mike is drawing and doing magic there, you know what you can do? You can hit the like button. Yeah. I know you can.
You crack me up.
You can make new accounts.
Yeah. You can take your time and make new accounts.
Don't tell them to cheat.
That's right. So here are the train tracks, right? This is probably the most famous version of drawing one point perspective. In fact, when I did a search for perspective and one point on YouTube, this showed up over and over and over again. And again, even in books that I've seen, I've seen this. I've seen this example, right? So this is wrong. Even something as simple as this, where we're just drawing train tracks, is wrong. Now, someone earlier had said, you know, the box had to have three points. And I wanted to clarify, you know, it has three surfaces. It's got to have three points. Well, the objects in this drawing have more than one surface as well. And if we just went to even the railroad ties, right? Here's this railroad tie, it's made of wood. the railroad tie itself has two planes, right? It's got a top plane and it has this front plane. So the top plane, yes, the top plane is going to the vanishing point, which is right there. This is called the vanishing point. Vanishing point. So the top planes, all each top plane of each railroad tie is making its way to that point. But guess what? There's a second surface, right? That these books seem to ignore. And that second surface is going to another point down below. And those angles will get stronger and stronger as they come to camera, and they would flatten out, you know, the further away we go, right? So even this simple example of saying, hey, this is one-point perspective is wrong. This is actually two-point perspective on a vertical line. Okay, and that vertical line is running up here, and there'd be a vanishing point way down below that all these front surfaces that I'm going to color in blue here just to make them more clear. You know, they're all going down, right? So blue is down and red is going to our vanishing point over there.
Okay. You're giving them creeps, you know.
Excuse me?
We are giving them creeps, you know. That we learned this thing from years and years, and today we're like, oh, this is 2 point, not 1 point.
Yeah, exactly, right? This is actually 2 point. Now, before I go on to the next level of this, I want to give you an example of going back to that earlier box that I don't want to forget here. What's wrong with that box, besides how we already figured out the issue with it, where does it show up where it really starts messing things up? Well, there's lots of places that this will mess things up if we draw this box. But I would say the most obvious one that I see show up in people's drawings is when they draw the head, as an example. So they'll draw somebody's face and they'll draw the face straight on, right, in a flat view, right? So let's say this is somebody's head. Okay. They'll draw a flat view of the face, and then yet they'll show us the head getting skewed off to the back side, and they'll show us a lot of the side of the head. Right. That's when I know, as soon as I see that, I'm like, oh, already something's off here. You know, this face would need to be adjusted into correct perspective instead of seeing this much of the other two planes. If you saw the front of somebody's face, then you see the front of somebody's face, right? Like, this is it. Sure, they have hair and all that other stuff. So you see a little like this at the top because our head's rounded. It's not a perfect box. And you might see past the turning edges, like the corners, because our face is around. Then you'll see somebody's ears, right? Of course. But you won't see this. Like, this would never happen, right? So, you know, be aware of yourself doing that. Like I said, this is the most common mistake I'll see. And this is a symptom of learning how to draw the bad perspective, okay?
That's so common in caricatures.
Yes.
You can see, like, everywhere that, yeah.
Yeah, no, that's very true. Okay, so how do we fix that box, right? I'm going to show you the solution finally to this box. I'll draw it in blue so we can do black on it correctly. Okay. So here's the box I drew for you before. We can do it the way my seventh grade teacher taught me. All right, we have this. This is the front plane. I'll make that a little thicker so we can see it. So this box is the problem, right? How do we fix it? It's got three planes, it's got these 90 degree angles. So these guys are already starting to go somewhere, right? And we can make them vanish, right? By saying they're gonna get to a point. So these two side lines, they're all going to one place, to one vanishing point. They can start to pinch in towards that point, right? So that starts fixing that. But the problem is we still have two other axes to deal with the box. So if I'm gonna see you know, this much of the side, right? Then that means I'm gonna have to cut into the front to allow the side view, the side with the X on it, to actually come around here. Let's call this our key leading edge. Okay, so this is a leading edge, not a leading edge, a turning edge, sorry. So this is a turning edge. Turning edge to me are edges that help turn surfaces, okay? So that's how I describe it. This is a turning edge. So around, it's like there's a pole here. You know, imagine this is like on a street or whatever. Here's a pole and we have this giant box and we want the side to come around, right? If I want this side to come around to the right, then the front is going to need to push its way back into space, okay? So as this side comes out, this side needs to go in, okay? So it comes in to about right here. And that means this is going to get adjusted to that, and that means this is going to get adjusted to that, like so, okay? So that, now if we want to pinch it, this is kind of the leader, and we'll talk about this in future perspective sessions, but this is sort of the leader. And then these guys can even pinch in further if I want to get to this point, okay? But this guy's driving the way based on this angle that I created here. Last but not least, so now we have a point all the way up here, right? This is our point on the right. There's gonna be a point off camera way to the left. And then I wanna deal with my verticals. So this guy's leading the vertical charge. These guys can't be straight. They would push down, right? They're gonna start pinching like this, you see? So, and they're converging on this center guy. So there is our actual box, right?
I hope that everyone is able to see the difference between the first cube, or the blue cube to call it, and this black cube. If you can see the difference, and if you notice and it feels better, just it feels better, when you see it, you're one step closer to be able to draw whatever you want to draw. But you need to be able to see the difference. Many people are commenting in the chat saying that one-point perspective is something to show whatever, or there's another comment talking about the head fitting better in a rectangular cube instead of a real cube. We know those little things, but what we're talking here is when we're drawing, we need to be able to see the reality. And with one point perspective, that's not even close to reality, okay? That's not how we see the world. So what we are trying with force is to be able to be honest with what we see every day in our life, to be able to draw and even to push further what we see. So that's the reason we are explaining perspective now.
Yeah, I'm glad you said that last thing there about to even be able to push further. Like, you're not gonna be able to push further if you don't know how to draw the truth in the first place, right? And this is visual truth, basically, that we're trying to give you. This is how our eyes, again, and brains work. And, you know, I could make this cube more dramatic or less dramatic. Like, if I took some of the pinching out of this, right, I would still, the box would still end up looking something like this. So notice this is a box with no pinching. We could, we see three surfaces. You guys will see it in a second. It's got three surfaces and yet it's correct. You know, it would be a box that's probably further away from me than close to me, because the closer an object comes to your round eyeball, the more push the perspective becomes, right? And the further away it is, the more parallel the lines become to one another. I always, when I'm teaching this, I talk about, imagine driving into a city and you're like 10 or 15 miles outside of the city and you can see it on the horizon, right? The buildings might actually look totally flat, right? You might see something that looks like this, right? From really far away. You'll see this come up in a moment on the right side. But when you're in the city and you're looking up at the buildings, right, all of a sudden the buildings are going to look more like the drawing on the right. So you got drawing one, which is from far away, and then drawing two, which is, you know, you standing right next to it, right? Okay. So those, you know, this, like I said, I want you to be aware of the fact, more than anything today, I'm trying to kill this idea of one point. I want you to be aware, one point really has no, I shouldn't say no use, but very little use, very, very little use. The only time you really get to one point perspective, I'm going to draw this in the top right corner. The only time you really get to one point perspective is if the horizon line and the crosshairs are literally smack in the middle of that box and you want to just draw right into that box. That's as far as you're going to get. Okay. As soon as you move a couple of degrees to the left, the right, or the top, or the bottom, you're moving out of one point into something else. You see, so there's really no room for it. You know, in fact, I saw a video on YouTube talking about drawing a room, you know, in this one point. And realistically, even if you started putting like tables and chairs and so on in this room, anything to the left of that one point that's going over here starts to get affected by a point that's far to the left, and anything to the right of that point starts getting affected to a point to the right. So when you have a point in an image, in a photograph, let's say, or you're creating your own concept art, if there's a point in the image, it's probably truly at least a three-point perspective image, because you're going to have stuff to the left and stuff to the right of it to be aware of, you see? Otherwise, you're just really creating a true like one-point perspective, which as we've seen today, really doesn't have much validity or much use, okay? Okay, so hopefully that all makes sense. If you guys have any questions, of course, you know, put them down in the chat. So I thought what I would do is share with you some video that I took to further support what we just talked about. I just shot this guys especially, I just shot this for you guys especially this week, just to share with you, you know, what's happening here with the box, okay? Okay, so here's our box, right? I'm holding a cardboard box. So now we have physical proof that I'm going to show you. This is not a magical box in any way, shape, or form. There's no trickery here. What you see is what you get. We can see the front of the box. Notice when I look dead on at this box, I'm not seeing the top. I mean, I'm not seeing the top. I'm not seeing the bottom, and I'm not seeing the sides, right? It's head on. It's facing the camera. That's it. The end, right? There's no more to this. The only way to get any use out of this box is as I just drew before, I can go into it, right? I can do this to it and that's it. Right. And that's why we can't see those other planes, right? Those planes are on those inside surfaces where my hands are on the sides of the box, right? They're already going to that point, which is in my body, basically, right? This is where the camera is pointing, right? So you want to be aware of that. So now what we're going to do is I'm going to scrub through this, and with the lag, hopefully I'll be able to make sense of all this. I see that right now you guys are starting to see the one point. So there's the one point of the box. Now what I'm going to do next is I'm going to slide the box to the right, and then I'm going to slide it to the left. Now, what you'll see here is as I slide the box to screen right, it's going to start presenting the left side of the box. And I want you to be aware, and this is very subtle, but the top edges of the box, right, they have to start moving, that means, right? I see, that's why. Let's get this nice and long there. So that means these guys here, they have to start pinching. You know, the line at the top and at the bottom will start pinching itself off to the right because I'm revealing the left side of the box. Now, I didn't turn the box, by the way. Something to keep in mind here is I didn't turn it at all. I kept this parallel, you know, to my camera, or perpendicular, depending on how you want to think about it. But I didn't rotate the box, okay? And you can see by presenting that left side, the front face immediately starts getting affected, okay? So you'll see that coming up. Yeah, so you guys see it there. So now I'm going to do the same thing. I'm going to move it to the other side of the screen, right? And the same thing starts to happen. You know, this will start making its way up. This will start making its way down, right? Because we're starting to show the side of the box, okay?
Mike, just to make sense of the delay we have, you can do it in real time. They will get it real time, but seconds later that you do it.
Okay, thank you. All right, so we have all that. Let's see, select all, delete. Let's keep scrubbing through this. So you can see I'm doing it with the bottom, and then I'm doing it. So here I moved away so you can see me go straight down, and you'll notice that we see the top, and that means the front face starts to get affected. The front face is now basically going to start, you know, pinching. I'm exaggerating here, but it starts pinching down here. Let me just do it right. All right, this is like this, and this is like this, because we see just a little bit of the top surface. Right. And then here I start to actually turn the box, right? So I step in towards the camera and I'm turning the box. And you can see that by me turning it, all the different surfaces start to change, right? Okay. And now here finally is the actual box itself, right? So here is the box and the orientation that we were trying to get to. This is the correct box in comparison to that front surface. If we want to see the top and the side and the front somewhat equally, like that original bad box I drew, the box would need to look like this, right? So see, you know, remember we started with the front looking like this, right? Straight on. Okay. And look at how far we've had to move with the diagonals to actually make that front surface connect with the top of the box and the side of the box going in certain perspective, right? So
Mike, there's a really good question in the chat that is, does the camera lens distort the perspective at all?
Yes.
And that's a great question. Yeah, even our eyes distort the perspective.
Yeah, most definitely. You know, like our eye is round, right? We are fish-eyed, right? We have round eyeballs. So anytime the closer an object is to your eye, the more distorted it gets, and the further away, the less distorted. So going back to the city view outside of a city driving in, there's no distortion. It'll look flat. And yet when you're in the city and you look at buildings, right, they get totally distorted because you're so close, right?
Okay. I want to answer Gabe Carroll that is asking, isn't this two-point perspective? And no, this is not. As we mentioned before, if you see three planes of the object, mm-hmm. it has to be three-point perspective.
That's right.
Because, Mike, can you show the three X's where they're vanishing? So I hope that answered your question, Gabe.
So here's one, here's two, and three is down there. You've got one, you know, you got 2 points on the horizon, right? That's points one and two, and number three in this case is down below, right? Okay, so that's a three-point perspective box. Okay, let's see. Let's keep moving with my video here. I want to show you one other thing in here that I did. Okay, here's me turning it. I want you to see just if we don't even see the third point, meaning that we're seeing the top or the bottom, what we're doing here is by me rotating it, you're seeing a two-point perspective boxes, and you can see how much one plane has to change compared to another plane, okay? All right, so let's see, what's next in this video? Now I show that with the top and the bottom. You know, notice if I wanna tilt and I wanna see the top, again, look at just how dramatically the angles of the bottom, here, let's try yellow. The angles of the front face start to angle downward if I want to see the top of the box, right? So this is all, it's pretty drastic actually, right? So you got to be really, really sensitive to angles. Abstractly speaking, perspective is all a game of angles. It's you understanding how angles relate to one another to make sure everything works, okay? All right. So last but not least, I tried to imitate what we started seeing before, okay? So here's that same box, except I folded all the flaps into the box. And what you're gonna see me do here is say, okay, I'm gonna try to show the side and keep the front flat, okay? So there it is, right? We got a flat front. I'm not showing the top. That would be even more challenging to make it work. But so here's the front and here's the side, kind of like the box we drew before. But that means the box is doing this, you see? So that is not a box anymore, right? That's not a box with hard 90 degree corners. This is what most artists, when they're starting to learn how to draw, this is what they end up drawing. And as you can see, it's skewed perspective. It's not correct relative to the true validity or rigidity of the box, right? So this is basically the demise of those 1-point perspective boxes. This is what you want to be careful of, okay? That is not a good perspective box, right? I think that's pretty much it. I show a couple more times that we really want that rigidity, right? You see, we want the hard 90 degree corners, right? And that's it. So hopefully this helps you guys get a sense of what really does work and doesn't work in perspective, okay? All right. So let's see, let's close off here. We're gonna move.
So this is our official funeral for perspective.
Exactly. Everyone get out a flower to toss on the dirt.
And now that you're talking about it, I just wonder, like, how is it that no one like realizes before? I mean, all these books and all these teachings out there, and it's wrong.
Yeah. Yeah, I don't know. It's interesting. I don't know where, I mean, perspective goes back hundreds and hundreds of years. And it was, I think, really powerful, right, for those first people to be able to draw two lines converging to a point, because it immediately gives you a sense of depth, right? Like, that's what's amazing about perspective. But like we hopefully showed you today, it doesn't really work, you know, and if it does, it's in a very finite space where it has any kind of function at all. Now, simply put, I would say one thing that's really powerful about the 1-point idea is just the understanding that when you have a point, you know, if you have a point and you have two lines that go to any kind of point, you're creating this kind of triangular shape, right? And that triangular shape immediately makes your brain think things are smaller here and they're bigger here. Ah, I must be seeing space. That is very powerful, right? Very, very powerful to give your flat two-dimensional plane a sense of depth, right? I mean, really, if we think about it, all I did was draw a dot and a couple of lines, and immediately my brain thinks there's space on the page, but it's not. Maybe this is just a triangle, right? I'm just doing this with a dot at the end of it. It could be, it is flat, right? There is no perspective on the piece of paper. This is all man-made, right? It's all fake, right? So it's really powerful to be aware of that too. So in that way, I'd say 1-point, it's only use is just understand the idea that when lines pinch to a point, you're starting to create fake depth, you know, on the piece of paper. We just want more points. The 1-point itself doesn't have much use. All right, so let's go on. We're checking likes. Obviously, we're really low today. So I would say those of you that are here, just hit the like button if you're enjoying the video so far on perspective, and hopefully it's clarified for some of you some of the challenges that you may have had with perspective. And let's get on to you guys and taking a look at the critiques, right? So this is Breno. I loaded in all your work, Breno. I thought it was quite interesting what you were sending in here. A lot of variety. You're kind of all over the place in how you're working, and there's certain aspects of almost every drawing that I like, and things, and there's things I think you should watch out for, you know. So let's take a look. Like in this one, as an example, I like that you're using what I call the bounding box. This is different than the perspective, everyone. I just like that you saw this flat shape of the back and you were trying to use it and like square it off, and it starts to like caricaturize. You're forming an opinion about what you're drawing, which is really cool. The issue with this drawing is there's just not really much force to it, right? This guy, you know, is sitting in this chair, right? His back is, I can see that one curve you put in the spine. I'm gonna use that, right? And I want that to flow into the side of this guy's head over here, right? So his head's like this. And then, you know, then it's coming down to the side of the back. So you can still do your sort of graphic abstractions, but you wanna try to keep things, you know, moving and alive and spatial and abstract, all that stuff at the same time, which I know is a lot to ask for, but that would be amazing, right? That'd be amazing to do that. So, you know, you get the back like this. This leg has no motion, the upper and lower don't, right? So this leg would go out to the knee and probably the front of the shin, right? Like so, and then that would get you to the foot. So you need these directions, right? Very clear directions first. Let's see, I brought in almost everything you sent. So I'm going to kind of quickly go through yours. This, I love your confidence in line and in the stroke. The challenge here is it feels like a drawing for the sake of like, ooh, look at my drawing, look at my line, You know, it doesn't have real function to it. There's no real rhythm to it. You know, it's more like graphic design to me. It's the idea of saying like, hey, look at this straight line, look at this straight line. But it's not functioning. That's really my issue. Any of you guys have anything you want to add to this one?
Yeah. Go ahead, written shape. Yeah.
No, I'm just saying it's more like more shape driven or something. So I like love the confidence of you, but it's now your first thing you should be going for is function. Yeah.
That's yeah, you can do this same type of design, and just by basing on a functionality, you'll get these beautiful shapes and it will work, you know, like two for a price.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah.
What I was going to say is this is not wrong, because if this is your style and you want to do it like this forever, go ahead. If people like it, it's okay.
Right.
But on the figure drawing perspective point, let's use the word perspective, you're missing function here. So that those straights you have there are breaking the life of that figure. You're creating a figure with two straight that make it really too solid, but also too stiff. So I like it. I really like that drawing. So I'm not saying that is wrong. I'm just saying that you could, I just said it a second ago. You can add a lot more fluidity to this drawing if you want to, by understanding the function of those straight and make them more a curve that shows the function of the back, for example, of that girl that is going there.
I mean, what you're hearing is really the same from all of us. And the idea is it's a cool looking drawing, right? But it doesn't work realistically. That's all, right? Like, we all like your confidence in line. I like the sort of abstraction that you have going on here. But if you want to learn from us about force, it's not a forceful drawing. So force is not purely about good line. It's about like how is she doing this, and how does the whole body come together as a system to do so? So, you know, here she might've been bending more and like pushing into this shoulder, right? Like so. And then that would have probably went into a reverse, you know, force into her hand like this to allow the fact that her shoulder's leaning forward, right? And that would have been, this would be the leading edge, by the way, right? And this is probably a C torso, my guess for now. I'd have to see the actual reference, but I would say this is probably a C. Could have been an S. This is outside thigh, inside knee, outside calf. You almost got that going there on that leg. And then this leg is, chances are this leg is also an outside thigh, inside knee, outside calf, like so, because it's a front view of the leg. So then this starts creating a system, and then the neck and the head. Then this creates a system in the body that allows us to drive through the whole thing, right? It's all connected. And that's always the goal to force into these rhythms, is to understand how the whole body comes together as one, right?
So if you abstract the shapes off of that, then you have a drawing that works and you have great abstract shape design, you know?
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, that kind of leads right to this one, right, Swenley? I mean, this to me looks like two ellipses. I just see this and maybe a box, right? So even if somebody is, you know, a different shape design, they're a little heavier, you still want to try to figure out how you're going to get good shape out of this. You know, really the force of this is coming from the back to the stomach. So my straight shape would be here, even with her breast sitting on top of it. I want straight there. And then this curve over here, and this would be a smaller curve or probably a small straight for the lumbar region of her back. And that little straight is what balances us out against the big stomach, right? And then, you know, again, if you're going to go right for shapes, the challenge with it is you got to know how to let those shapes live and connect, you know. So this needs to be maybe longer if you want to keep force going down the front. Then you can get into the short gastrocnemius or calf muscle and, you know, hook us into the heel, you see. So I personally, looking at your work in totality, I love your confidence. I love that it looks like you're really enjoying drawing. I really love that you have a ton of opinion. I think that is extremely valuable. I think it's one of the hardest things to teach, is for somebody to have something to say in their work. You know, and you're doing that. You know, you have almost your own sense of like how you're caricaturizing things. I think what I ask of you is bring force into that mix, you know, understand how things work, let that lead you with your opinion about how you think about the way you see the world, right? And allow the stuff to become more forceful. Because here again, you're the trap you're running into shape-wise is you're creating a lot of sort of dead symmetrical shapes, you know, and then it just doesn't become clear as to where things are going. This arm is a straight line. See, there's another, it's almost like bubbles, right? These ellipses are like balloons. So it starts killing movement. And this, you know, and force could be a way of exaggerating. For those of you that don't know, like, you know, each one of us here today has a an Instagram. Mine's just my name. And I just posted a video late last night. So go check that out. That video shows me exaggerating off of a reference image. And it shows me drawing that image, you know, that reference three times using force as the exaggeration tool. You know, so it's like, huh, how am I going to get this guy to push into that shoulder? How humped do I want his back, like hunched over, right? You know, what am I going to do there? That's all coming from energy. So I'm exaggerating the energy of the figure. Okay. And that's definitely something we're going to talk about, I think, in a future live session as well. Oops. So same here. You got a lot of skills. You got great hand control. You have a lot of opinion, which I think is awesome. Just need to get more force into these and allow that to guide you as to how you shape design. Okay. So thank you for submitting, Breno. It was quite exciting looking at your work, and hopefully we'll see more of you in the future.
Yeah.
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 Okay. Let's see. We've got Devashish, right? Devashish. Let's see. So some good forces, right? The beginning, you know, the beginnings, when I look at this drawing, I think, oh, it's kind of generic, right? Like we just left Breno and it was the opposite. It was like very specific opinion, right? But what is working here, even though we don't have like opinion about specificity, what we have is somebody who's really trying to flow around the body. And I can look at this and see that the whole thing is holding together. Right. So you want to get here first, everyone, right? You want to get to a place where the whole drawing is holding together. And then you start leaning more towards like what Breno is doing. So Breno, what I'm asking you to do is kind of come back here a little bit more, just try to get a little more fluidity into your work and then put on top of it all of your like opinion. And force again itself could be an opinion all on its own. Right. So not bad. There's some pretty good stuff going on here, some good forces. I'd probably suggest to you to stay away from shape right now, because you have some good forces and then yet you went in and you created a, again, it's almost the balloon shape here, this ellipse, you see? Mm-hmm. So instead of just saying, you know what, I think this is a, you know, a front of thigh, back of calf, for instance, I think it's like that. And then this, it looks like you're trying to, I think you're trying to draw turning edges or it's a center. I don't know. This looks like you drew the turning edge, but this line over here, it wouldn't be there. This leg would probably be like here. I'd say this is the front and this is the side.
To me, those lines are just the structure. Here, I think he drew like the structure of
like that, a stick figure kind of thing.
Right? Like it's kind of the line of action of the leg.
Right, right. Like. Yeah, it's like a stick figure force thing, yeah. Right? Maybe. It could be.
Yeah, you can see like he go from thigh to the back of the calf, you know, in the line of action. Then he just formed a bit of shape.
Mm-hmm.
So it's kind of like that.
Yeah, yeah. So he kind of did this and this and then said, okay, let me like put these on here.
Yeah. Right.
Yeah. What we're really doing, to be simple, is in the beginning of learning force, you're actually drawing the contours, right? So you don't want to draw like a stick figure in the middle and then try to plug the shape on top of it. We are drawing contours at the beginning. You want to find out how you're pushing against those contours. So I don't know whose this is because it just said draw F. As the file name, you know, you want to put your name in here. So I'm not sure who I'm addressing, but it's obviously somebody on drawingforce.com. I don't think there's a name in it either. No. Let's see if anyone owns up to this in the in today's chat. But these are pretty darn good, right? Really great forces, great rhythms. Everything's connecting. They're connecting the body. There's a little bit of form in here. Yeah, really nice. Really, really nice. It looks like you're watching that other, the other video as well. These all look really good. I like how you crossed over from the back and down. It's very good. Yeah, not much to say outside of hopefully the rest of you can look at this and see, like, this is the beginnings, right? This is the beginning of somebody learning force basics. This is someone who's at like the end of force basics and is really pushing on the edge of, you know, I need to get into form, right? And you can see it's really contour driven based on what we just did with the other artist. You can see it's contour driven. We're driving from edge to edge and you want to flow through the body and you want to make sure you connect, you know, you want to connect from one place to another. Okay, this is Fargol, right? I'm happy this was sent in. I mean, first of all, as you know, we're probably not, or maybe someday, like 10 years from now, we'll talk about rendering. But usually we don't end up teaching rendering. But I do have to say, the lesson you learned on perspective today on one point and what works and doesn't work there and a turning edge, that has to, you have to understand that in order to render or paint well, okay? Because it's all about the turning edge and understanding how light goes around form. Okay. So I think a common mistake on the internet is I'm going to go learn how to render, right? Don't bother. Like, there's no reason to render if you don't know how to draw, right? Good rendering comes from understanding how to draw well. Okay. So the problem with this drawing, right? The issue that this artist has at this point is, again, force. This drawing is done through probably more of an atelier approach, where they're measuring out angles, right? It's like, let me get this. It's very careful. And I'm not a big fan of careful. I like success to come through practice instead of carefulness and accuracy coming from that way. So this, what's happening here is this is basically comes through measure. It comes through measuring angles. Shapes, right? Distances. And by the way, it's not like these are invalid. I do the same thing. I'm just not going to make this my focus. I kind of do this in the background while I'm trying to draw the force of the figure. So for you, Fargol, my first suggestion would be to loosen up. I would say loosen up and try to enjoy more the process of what the energy this poses. Right now, this is a C torso, right? Which, to be abstract, it's doing this, right? And it's pushing this way. And I don't feel that in the drawing. And you definitely didn't have the experience of it, right? This is more of like just trying to copy your reference through the angles, shapes, and distances, and then shaping out shadows and figuring out where there's hard edges and soft edges, right? It becomes a very, very mechanical approach, super mechanical. Instead of saying, you know what, I really want to feel the power of the body moving this way. You know, that's what makes this drawing stiff, even though this pose had a lot of drama. You know, the stiffness comes out of straight lines and the lack of continuity of rhythm in the figure, right?
And there's go ahead. Yeah, there's one very good example, you know, what we're talking about. Hope that you can see my annotations here. So yep. For example, this pelvis, you know, comes from here. Now in the drawing, this legs goes like this and this. Mm-hmm. So yeah, it's kind of like, this is about all function. If you know, you've really I mean if you're really, you know the function, then this lick would be going here and then here. So it would be like more dramatic, you know, really bring the drama of the force, I mean, figure. Mm-hmm. So now this is all about the function we're talking about. Now this is all okay, you know, this is maybe like okay. But, you know, for example, this is a life example here. Yeah, that's my 2 cents.
Yeah, I would, you know, I was going to say, and thank you for going there, that this leg here. Yeah, that leg there, it doesn't work because the curvature of the anatomy is incorrect. It's off. See, this leg, to Mrtunjay's point, it would come up and over. And even if you did stay here, this leg needs to go like this. That's the general direction of the force of that leg. So what happens with also the atelier approach here then is, man, you really are so reliant on only your eyes, right? It's like, that's where you're really starting. And sure, you can dig into anatomy and then it's like, okay, now I'm trying to make my eye see the anatomy. But the thing that's missing is I'm not looking for force, right? I'm not looking for how the body is alive, right? So I hope that all makes sense. I'm very, very happy that you sent this in, Fargal. I really appreciate it. Hopefully you don't feel like we're all sort of jumping on a trying to attack you with it. I want you to be aware, if you want to move forward with force, you've got to move away from just measuring your drawings out and measuring out angles. You'll never get there like that.
One good thing is that this person, I don't know if he's a she or a he, has a great eye.
Because that's right. Yeah, definitely. That's right. When we go to the three phases of drawing, the eyeball, the brain, and the hand, right? This person is very strong here. And you have some, obviously, some ideas here. But what's missing in the thought part is that you're not looking for force, right? And when you start thinking about it, you'll start actually seeing it. And then this whole cycle will start to rev up. You know, you'll start understanding how the whole thing works. So, all right, let's see. We have a couple more to go. I brought this one in, of course, because thank you, Jabril, for sending in something with perspective, right? So that's kind of cool. I'm going to just rotate this a little bit so we can straighten out your verticals. All right, so this drawing's more like that. Okay, so here's a great example of that whole one point thing we talked about, right? So if we've got this point of perspective that's up here somewhere, right? And you can see all these buildings are built off of that. That's great. We got one point over here. But these are boxes, right? These are basically boxes. So the one point is affecting all of the right planes, right? All the right surfaces, which means the left planes, which are over here. Here, let me, I'm going to tint them in really quickly. Let's use black. So all the left planes, they are affected by a point on the left-hand side that is further off the screen, you see? So all these guys here, there's another, basically another point that we have to work with that goes off, let me zoom out. There's another point here that's going to go off this way. You see? So even this, which is really very simply put, we're just drawing two-point perspective boxes in the scene. Right, it's like this, right? And this is the front of the stores and this is the sides or of these houses. You know, you got one point that's in the shot and there's another point that's like out here somewhere further out that you still have to work with, you see? Okay, so hopefully that makes sense. Thank you for sending that in. I appreciate that you actually went even with the topic of today's class. So very cool. All right, we've got one more. This is Swarup. Any of you guys want to jump in on this one?
Yeah, Diego, go ahead.
Okay. Throw me to the lions. Okay, now, let's talk about this as we've been talking before. There are good ideas and there are things that could be fixed, mainly shape. And this is why we suggest to new student to don't go into shape until you understand why you are closing shapes. What do you want to say about shapes when you're drawing? For example, in the left screen side drawing, we can see the arms. They're just two rectangles. So the drawing number one, Mike. Yeah, those are just two rectangles, and that what only creates our symmetrical shapes. And those shapes stop the motion we are trying to create. Okay. If you watch on the legs of that same drawing, you'll see on the knees that it's like they stop. It's like, yeah, you're going to show like the symmetrical shape on the top, that one, right? But what I want to say in the middle on the knees, it's just a straight line and a thin point where there should be a knee. There's nothing there. There's no bone. There's no muscle, anything. Mm-hmm. So I'm not talking about you need to learn anatomy to fix that. You know that people are not walking around with just a point between the top part of the leg and the bottom part of the leg. there's something there, right? So, and in the other drawing, the second drawing, the one thing missing there, I think it's almost there. It's not super big of an issue, but the balance is almost off. And that's one of the first thing we look for when people start drawing with force is understand that this person is standing on the surface and it needs to be balanced because it's affected by gravity. And even a non-artist, some people that is watching your drawing will realize that something is off. Even if they couldn't tell what it is, if that drawing is falling to a side or to the front or to the back, it is easily seen that is missing, that drawing it has no balance. So to me, this artist need to step back and start looking at those little things. Like, is this drawing balanced? For example, the right leg of the second drawing, the right leg of the person, that one, yeah. It looks really nice. It looks really nice because you have the curve on the front, the curve on the back of the, yeah, it's going front to back, and you have a straight on the front there. So you are creating nice shapes. That drawing, that leg is starting to look like something stylized leg of some cartoon you can see nowadays on TV, which is look great. It's really appealing. But on the other side, the other leg, it's missing some rhythms, right? You're missing the inside knee rhythm, for example. So there are many little things that we can start showing there. Thank you, Mike, for being my arm today.
Yep, no worries.
So there are little things that you're missing there. But first, balance is one of the most important you're missing here. So I would tell you, try not to close the shapes. Try to get, like, even with a stick figure, try to get it like balance on the page. Like, where is standing? I really like those. This is so small what I'm about to say. That line he put on this guy left foot.
The left foot.
No, the that one. Yeah, you see just those little lines. That shows me that is in a kind of perspective. No, not that one. The other one.
Yes,
I'm just talking about that one. Yeah, it shows me that this foot, that foot is coming towards us. So this guy is showing me the perspective plane where that figure is standing on. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So I really like that little doodle. But the thing is, you could make it more clear, you know. Because yeah, it can work like that, but you can be more clear about that. So, yeah, we can talk about the neck on the other drawing. Yeah. We again, doing something symmetrical there that is killing, the force of the drawing. But mainly that, try not to close the shapes, try to understand the rhythms of the figure and be aware of gravity and balance. That would be my complete, review of those drawings.
It's fair. I would, the only thing I would add here is I like your confidence. I like your line. Don't feel like you've got to do it in one shot. You know, you're doing a lot of, here, let me get rid of my notes here. You know, you're doing a lot of like, it's like that. And I got to get another cool line in there and that, right? You're probably years away from, quite frankly, trying to do it like that. Give yourself time to draw a lot on the piece of paper. I'd rather see somebody who's making a mess of the drawing and trying to figure things out than trying to do it in one shot. Forget the idea of one shot right now. One shot comes with lots of line practice, you know, 10,000 lines or 100,000 lines, whatever it takes. Draw and just try to figure this stuff out, you know. Feel this line, allow yourself to connect to the knee, flow through here. You know, get those rhythms. You are going to make a mess of things at the beginning, and that's fine. It's a dirty matter, you know, trying to understand how to draw. That's the work. It's almost like I'm giving you the job of saying, hey, I want you to be a car mechanic, and you don't want to get your hands dirty, right? You just want to, like, look cool while it's happening. And I don't care about looking cool, you know? That's the same thing we said with Breno. Great lines, right? But what we need is we need to see you guys working with force and trying to understand the energy of the body and how it connects. So don't get too caught up in the line just for line's sake. It's that you're using the line to represent the thoughts that you're trying to present, right?
Hey, Mike, I want to say something about the submission for the critiques. Guys, remember that every week is a different folder. So if you submit for the first one, we won't get those drawings. Every week you have to submit your drawing. So, and as you see, we just pick five because there's no much time. So right. If you want to get picked by us for the critique, please try to send, of course, at least 24 hours before the stream. So we can pick your drawings. And if you send, because Tommy Boy just asked, please, I need help. I submitted my drawing a week ago, but right. didn't turn up. I did something wrong, or you don't. It's not that you did something wrong. Last week drawings are deleted. So we have brand new drawings submissions this week.
Yes.
So for the next week, submit again. And one day we'll pick you. But we have a lot of submissions. So it is hard for us also to pick one or two or three.
Yeah, we try to make sure that we don't keep picking the same people over and over again. I want to give everyone a chance. And also, hopefully you guys have noticed now the folder system works. We were on Google Share before and it kept pushing it into view only and you guys couldn't get access. So I finally pushed everything over to Dropbox. So it looked like it worked well today. We got a bunch of submissions, as Diego was saying. So Tommy, again, you're not doing anything wrong. So that's it, guys. Thanks for coming today to our session on perspective. I think next week, a great topic for us to work on would be like pushing poses. So, you know, go check out, if you haven't already, my Instagram account and Mertunje's and Diego's and Swenley's. They're all typically like under our names in some way, shape, or form. And they're also in the, you know, the write-ups underneath the video. You'll see there a video of me like really pushing a reference, you know, further and further and further. So I think that'd be a fun idea. We'll cut back to force since we covered some perspective today. Okay. All right, everyone. Thanks for joining us. And we will see you next Friday at the same time. Take care and have a great weekend. Stay safe. And we'll see you in 7 days. Bye-bye.
Yes, see you guys.
Guys. Bye-bye.